Now, most things I do start as an idea. I take the idea and I write it down. I mean, I write it down so I can see it. The idea becomes more real, more attainable, more tangible. That's the first step in heading towards our goals, but not in this case. In this case, I just saw something on Instagram and I wanted to make it. So I made it. What's up, everybody? Thanks for tuning into the channel, LoveFoodMore with Joshua Walbolt. That's me. So today we're gonna be making something super exciting. I was super excited to make it, so excited that I couldn't sleep. I was scrolling through Instagram and I saw this video of c.hercreations making this beautiful pandan honeycomb cake. And I was like, I have to make this because I grew up eating this dish. I love this cake. Every time I saw it at this restaurant in Minneapolis, I would always eat it and I would always buy it. And it was like $6 for like two or three slices. So I was so excited when I could make an entire brownie pan full of it and just have it all to myself. So we're gonna make the recipe today. I was super scared to make it. I don't know why I never thought to make it before. Maybe I was just scared to butcher it and then I would just hate it because I screwed it up so bad. Or maybe I was intimidated by it. Maybe I didn't want to ruin my childhood memories of this place. So I kind of did a variation of it. Instead of doing the pandan flavor, I did ube. So ube is a sweet purple potato and it looks super cool in this recipe. So definitely try this out because it was not terribly difficult. It was pretty simple, pretty straightforward. And this is my first time making it. And let me know what you think of how it turned out. If you haven't yet, make sure you hit that like button and subscribe to the channel because we're gonna be cooking up some more recipes together and getting you to love food more. So thank you for tuning in. Enjoy this recipe. The first thing we're going to do is preheat our oven to 350 degrees Fahrenheit. And while we are doing that, we're going to add our pan of choice into the oven. Here I'm just using a brownie pan from Allclad, and we're just gonna let that preheat while we do the rest of our steps. First things first, we're going to add into a pan some granulated white sugar, and then we're gonna add our can of coconut milk. I like to use Choco coconut brand milk because it's a brand that my family has used forever and I just never veered away from it. Use a can opener over the top. It's a good idea to shake the can before because sometimes the coconut fat and the milk likes to separate. So just mix it together so it becomes nice and homogenous. Once the coconut and sugar is into a pan, we're going to scrape off as much as we can, and then we're going to sprinkle a little bit of salt in there. This is going to help bring everything together and balance the sweetness of the entire cake. Over a stove or a medium-high heat flame, we're going to add that pan with the coconut milk and the sugar and salt, and give it a nice little whiskity whoop until it is all nice and the sugar is dissolved. We don't want to bring it to a boil because we just want to temper that. Now set it somewhere to chill, over in the fridge or over a bowl of ice, up to you. I just set it aside while I cracked these huevos into a bowl. Into a bowl, we cracked 6 eggs, and we're just going to give them a little poke, and we're not going to whisk them too aggressively just because we want to help keep the egg structure alive. This is going to help give us a honeycomb texture in our cake. And plus, we mix it about 3 or 4 more times when we add the rest of our ingredients. You'll see here shortly. Once that is kind of mixed, we're going to add our chilled coconut syrup mixture into this little bowl and continue to mix it. Again, we don't want to break up the egg yolk and the whites too much. Now we're going to add this little secret ingredient here. This is the ube extract flavoring from McCormick. You can find this on Amazon or some grocery stores. If you find it at an Asian market, go ahead and buy all of it like we do because it's only $3 at the Asian markets most of the time versus on Amazon it's like $6 to $7 per 3-milliliter container like this. So we just did a little dab. You can find a link for that down below if you want to buy that. I don't know how much to add, so I added a little bit. You can always add more. It's easier to add more than it is to take out. So I ended up adding about a tablespoon and a half more of the ube extract, which came out to this nice deep purple color that I did enjoy thoroughly, as you can see. It looks kind of like a Viking helmet. Go Minnesota, yeah. Okay, now once that is gone, we're going to add it into a bowl of mochiko rice flour, as well as some tapioca starch and a little bit of baking powder. Once that's all in there, we're gonna give it a little whiskity whoppity whoop until it is combined. We don't have to worry about building any gluten because this is a gluten-free dough or cake or batter. Once we're gonna add our egg yolk and coconut mixture into the
flour, and we're going to give it a nice little whisk again. Again, don't worry about whisking it too much, because we're going to strain it through a strainer here in a minute. And hey, if you haven't subscribed yet, make sure you subscribe. It really helps out, and like, you know, appreciate that. Anyways, back to the video. We're going to do a little strain. So I have a little strainer here, and we're going to pour the batter through this. This is just going to help get rid of any clumps that are kind of like big in excess. And just keep doing this until you push everything through. This might take a little bit, but fear not. It's worth it. Some other tools you can use are a ladle. Rubber spatula seems to work well for me. If you're using a china cap, a ladle might be your preferred method. Make sure you scrape off the bottom of the pan as well, and then we're going to add a little bit of coconut oil. It is warm coconut oil, so it is nice and melted and liquidy. That's going to help bring that coconut aroma to the party. Look at that. We have a nice smooth batter ready to go into the pan. So we're going to set this aside, and we're going to grab a can of Pam and give a nice little spray to our hot preheated pan. Now we're going to pour the batter into the pan ever so nicely and calmly. And you want to do this pretty quickly, not slow motion like I'm doing here, because we want to get it right back into the oven so it can help rise to the occasion. You know what I mean? We're going to add a little pan underneath just in case it decides to drip over. I haven't put this batter in this pan before, so we're going to try it out. At 350 degrees, remember, we're going to cook for about 45 minutes. 40 to 45 minutes, depending on how strong your oven is. My oven is weak sauce, so we're going to do 45. I came back about 44 minutes later to check it out, and it was like, boom. I was like, yo, what's up? I'm popping on one side. So I was like, let me check. So I put a little cake tester inside, and if it comes out clean, you're ready to go RTG, baby. But, you know, I thought it was good to go. So I took the timer off, and then I left the oven door open, left it in there for about 20 more minutes per recipe, and just let it chill. And while I was chilling, it came out and it kind of leveled out, so it was kind of cool. And I kind of deflated. I was like, oh man, I actually kind of wanted to try it while it was nice and puff daddy, but this works. You should be able to just give a little flip flop and it should come out just like that, little drip drop. It looks a little awkward. It's not as purple as I wanted it to be, but then I was like, yo, let's cut into this bad boy. You should wait about 10 or 15 minutes while I rest on a rack, but I was too excited, so I dove in, grabbed a serrated knife, and just cut it open. And the smell, I was like, oh my god, it so smells so good. So then I opened it up, and it was like, what's up? Now, if you look at the texture inside, you can tell it's like that nice gummy tapioca type texture that I think a lot of Southeast Asian people are very fond of. And it is very stretchy, has a very nice bounce to it, which was super delicious, and I was so excited to eat it. It was crispy, crunchy on the outside, chewy texture on the inside, and it was so nice. It tastes so good the next day. I mean, look at the stretch on it. It's like I can pull this thing like a freaking piece of bubblegum. And I was like, hello, how are you? I'm gonna rip right into here. It was so good. And this will last on your counter for probably 2 to 3 days. I have some extra dough I put in the freezer because I don't eat that much and no one really eats that much. But it tastes great. So, if you like what you saw, make sure you subscribe and follow along the journey as we come cook up some more recipes. You know, it does a lot of work to make these videos, and all I'm asking for is a like and subscribe if you really liked it and you really want to see me cook up some more stuff. I have one goal over here for all y'all that love food, and that is to get you to love food more. And we're going to do that by staying happy, staying hungry, by feeding your soul and feeding your mind. Stay tuned until next time. Much love, y'all. Peace.
Are you awake now? Are you awake now?
Who's that?